Hello, my name is John Schmidt, and I'm an engineer at Ohio EPA's Northeast District Office located in Twinsburg, Ohio. And I'm here to talk about wastewater and stormwater considerations for vineyards. This is a series of outreaches that were provided to wineries in the northeast part of the state. There were three outreach efforts held, one down in Millersburg of Holmes County, another one in Perry in Lake County, and another one in Vermilion on the Lorain County line. Ohio EPA has five district offices and a central support office. I am from the Ohio EPA Northeast District, and our address and directions are given there on the slide. We have a district office in the northwest, located in Bowling Green, and southwest, located in Dayton, central district office located in downtown Columbus, and the southeast district office located in Logan. For folks wanting to start up a new winery or to expand an existing winery, there's some coordination that is required with Ohio EPA's Division of Surface Water. These include if you want to land apply residuals, like the crushed grapes and stems back onto farm fields. For the land development in constructing like the wine tasting rooms and associated structures. You're going to need coordination if you're doing any impacts to wetlands. And typically these wineries are located where there are not sanitary sewers available, so you would have to have some type of on-site wastewater treatment for your domestic waste. And there are considerations for stormwater even following construction. For land application of residuals, there is something called a land application management plan that would be required. It is not required for residuals that do not leave the field. So for parts of the harvest, of collecting the grapes, if the grapes are left in the field or a portion of them are left in the field, that falls under Ohio Department of Agriculture rules and does not fall into ours. But once you collect the grapes and you bring them in and you crush them to start to make the wine, then the control of that material does fall under our jurisdiction. So if you're making wine, spirits, or land applying, you want to land apply those materials back to the farm field, it requires some coordination from us. We typically require an industrial holding tank for the materials, because it's typically a higher strength wastewater from the crushing operations, the cleaning of the vats and the tanks, and something called a land application management plan for liquids and solids. There are forms for the going through that process that are on Ohio EPA's website at epa.ohio.gov/dsw, and then from the pick down menu, look on permit to install applications, and that will take you to the appropriate forms that you will need. If you want to construct something that is more than an acre in size or part of a larger development that will be larger than an acre, you require a construction stormwater permit. There are two types of permits throughout the state. One permit is an individual permit. It's by individual site. However, construction stormwater permits are issued under a statewide permit. And then there is one general permit that is issued for all construction sites across the state, and individual projects will need to apply for coverage under that existing general permit. You submit something called a Notice of Intent, or NOI form, and that form may be found at Ohio EPA Surface Water Division at epa.ohio.gov/dsw, and then from the topic list, scroll down to stormwater. Note that this would exclude the actual vineyard development itself. So this would be looking at the total area disturbed for, say, parking areas and construction of any buildings associated with winemaking or the wine tasting or retail sales. It is required that the development exceeds 1 acre, and it requires you to develop something called a stormwater pollution prevention plan. That is something that is typically developed in conjunction with an engineering company that's preparing any plans and stuff for the development of your site. And Ohio EPA guidance may be found at epa.ohio.gov/dsw/storm/index.aspx, as given at the bottom of the screen. There is also a general handout that is available at Ohio EPA's website for small construction projects requiring stormwater permits. It is offered through Ohio EPA's Office of Compliance Assistance and Pollution Prevention. It is dated August 2007 and is available from any of the district office that would provide more details on that. If you're going to be impacting wetlands, wetlands here in the state of Ohio are regulated by both Ohio EPA and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. It depends upon whether or not the wetlands are considered part of navigable waters or if they are isolated wetlands. The initial determination is made by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. And up here in the northeast part of the state, if you are within the watershed area draining north to Lake Erie, it is handled out of U.S. Army Corps of Engineers Buffalo, New York office, and they have a field office located down in Orwell. There's a jurisdictional determination that is made. You basically contact the Army Corps of Engineers, and they come out and they examine the area to determine whether or not it's a jurisdictional wetland under their program. You would also then want to follow up with Ohio EPA's district office contact for wetlands to find out if you need any additional permitting from Ohio EPA as well. If you're going to be filling a wetland, allowable fill area depends upon the wetland class, class 1, 2, or 3 for the type of wetlands. And obviously, the more sensitive the wetland, the smaller allowable fill area is allowed. So there are some public notice and hearing requirements, and that may add substantial time. So you would need to plan accordingly for that if you think or you may be impacting wetlands to account for those public noticing and hearing requirements. Guidance on that, it may be found at the website listed on the bottom. It's called our Ohio EPA 401 program, and it actually refers to a section of the Federal Clean Water Act, Section 401, that deals with wetlands. There is a fact sheet on wetlands that may be available through our district offices and is found on our website. It's titled Ohio Wetlands, and it's dated January 2006. For sanitary sewer systems, typically, you're going to need to have some type of an on-site system if sanitary sewers are not available. As a majority of our wetlands, a majority of our vineyards are located outside of where sanitary sewers are available, you're typically going to need to have sanitary sewer system, and that is going to require something called a permit to install from Ohio EPA. Oftentimes, vineyards are converted from existing family farms, and family farms are typically covered under home septic systems that are through local health departments. So you may be trying to convert an existing residential system to commercial, and you would want to start by contacting Ohio EPA's appropriate district office and speaking to the contact person for that particular county to see what's possible. Also, new wastewater sources are going to be adding to it from if you're going to be having a tasting room with sanitary service expected from restroom facilities as well as any kitchen or glass washing operations that you may have. It does require a permit to install through Ohio EPA. I do want to caveat that with it varies by counties of whether or not they participate in something called the Small Flows Program. The Small Flows Program is a voluntary program that health departments may want to choose to participate in, and they obtain a memorandum of understanding with Ohio EPA, and then they are permitted to essentially approve systems that are under 1,000 gallons per day in their particular counties. And it varies by county. So you probably want to check with the appropriate district office contact person to find out if your county has a health department that is participating in that small flows program. So keep in mind that the presentation given here is assuming that the application would have to be processed by Ohio EPA. Sanitary systems fall into one of two categories. One is if you have a system that discharges into the ground, such as a mound system or a tile field, or a drip system that goes into the ground. That typically does not require a discharge permit because it is going into the ground and not having a pipe or point discharge. If you have a system that requires a pipe or point discharge, in addition to a permit to install, you may need a discharge permit. The term for it is National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, NPDES permit, and that would cover the requirements for monitoring and management of your system if you're going to discharge a pipe to waters of the state. What you want to do first is to contact a wastewater design engineer and speak with them regarding your plans for what you want to do, not only now, but in the future, and you can plan out an appropriate system accordingly. Ohio EPA cannot recommend a specific professional engineering firm or person. Ohio EPA does require a permit to install. Health department requirements may vary. They may follow a permit to install process or something similar. Permits to install must be prepared by an Ohio professional engineer. That is a requirement of Ohio EPA's laws and Ohio EPA's rules. Soils in many counties have limited suitability for on-site soil. I have Ashtabula County myself, and many of the soils in big portions of that county are not suitable for an on-site system. You want to make sure that you discuss site plans both short-term and long-term. You want to be thinking ahead because these systems are very expensive to go back and retrofit. So you want to kind of see where you plan on being now, as well as where you're going to be within the next 3 years or 5 years, so you can have a system that is appropriate for what you want to do. As part of the permit to install process, the design engineer will typically work with a qualified soil scientist. Ohio EPA does maintain a list of qualified soil scientists at its website at epa.ohio.gov/dsw, and then from that topic list, scroll down to permits to install, and then use the tab for on-site systems. There is a link to qualified soil scientists. Typically, an engineering firm that you would be selecting to work on the design of your system will have a number of qualified soil scientists that they work with. Years ago, Ohio EPA used to rely upon a soil survey for a general county. There's a picture of one on the slide. These soil surveys were typically produced right after World War II and were an estimation or approximation of the type of soils that would be in your area. Ohio EPA has found that in some cases, these soil reports may not be accurate as to the type of soil that you may have in your particular site. So it's always best to actually have a soil sample taken and confirm the type of samples that you have at your site so that an appropriate system can be designed. One of the things that would be determined as part of the soil survey is if you have any limiting conditions. Limiting conditions can include near surface bedrock and seasonal high water table as well as high water table. It may even determine whether or not the soils that you may have may not be suitable for an on-site system, such as soils that get wet and stay wet for certain times of the year that are defined by the U.S. Department of Agriculture as hydric. There are forms for completing the soil evaluation, and it is Form B13 under the PTI form at the website that is given at the bottom of the page. The site evaluation is in addition to the soil evaluation, and the site evaluation tells Ohio EPA and or your health department of what is going to be the expected wastewater characteristics going to the wastewater system, both in terms of flow as well as strength. You want to identify all wastewater sources, and these would include the extent of kitchen facilities that you have, the extent of food preparation that you plan on making, how many seats you're going to have both inside and outside, and a proposed menu of what you plan on serving. Forms for the site evaluation are found at the website given on the slide. Establishment of design flow is given in the Ohio Administrative Code and is listed there as Rule 3745-4205. You want to think long-term, where you want to be not only now, but within 5 years. Because as I said earlier, these systems are very expensive to go back and retrofit. And you want to be able to think about where you want to be in the future so your system can be adequately sized now and or sized in such a way that it can be added onto modularly with the least amount of expense further down the road. Ohio EPA also looks at the maximum amount of expected flow from your system. So So you want to make sure that you're accounting for your system for your heaviest flow days, which are typically weekends during the summer months. Design flow considerations includes the average daily design flow and is given in Ohio's Administrative Code Rule 374205. Typically, for employees, we assume a flow rate of 15 gallons per day, line pacing with limited food preparation and prepackaged foods can range from 5 to 7 gallons per day per seat. However, if you are migrating into something more of a full food preparation that includes a lot of dishwashing and pots and pan washing, you have a restaurant or tavern may assume upwards of 30 to 35 gallons per day per seat, plus the wastewater that would be expected would be considered a high-strength wastewater. So you can see that there's quite a range of which the flow can be expected to go to a system depending upon what you're trying to do. Flow equalization, you want to have flow equalization for special events. So what flow equalization does is it temporarily stores incoming wastewater to kind of even out the flow through your system so that you have a steady flow rate through the system and to shave off those peaks and valleys from high, low, and low flow events. You also may want to consider catered events of which a licensed caterer brings food in and takes food out and takes all dishware and pots and pans off-site for preparation instead of doing it at your site if it's something that you don't do very often or would only be doing as a special event, like such as a wedding. There are advantages to both a discharging system versus an on-site system. A discharging system, and I do show a typical system there in the background. It was for one of my taverns that is located up in Ashtabula County. A discharging system requires a licensed operator, and these are required in Ohio EPA's operation rules of 3745-7. Analytical costs, a discharge permit. High-strength wastes are okay because they're specifically set up to deal with higher-strength wastewater. The system can go into a smaller footprint than an on-site system, but you must have a suitable receiving stream. And what I have down here as the last bullet here is, for example, in my district and in my county, there's a moratorium against no new discharges for the Grand River watershed. So you want to be aware of that if there is a restriction on your watershed of where your vineyard is proposed to be located. For on-site systems, you have limitations on the wastewater strength and flow rate. Typically, systems that are under 1,000 gallons per day is what is used for on-site systems. However, you are limited by soil and footprint. Soil-based systems can take up a considerable footprint, and you need to have appropriate soils. The soils also, by the way, must be undisturbed. So it's important during site development that any area that you're designating to put your system is basically roped off or fenced off in such a way that contractors do not run heavy equipment over the top of it, or that it is plowed up or otherwise disturbed, or you may not be able to use that for a soil-based system. On-site systems typically have fewer moving parts, so there's lower operation and maintenance costs. They do not necessarily require an operator or have the analytical requirements that a discharging system would have. And in the eyes of Ohio EPA, we always tend to look at on-site systems before we start to look at a system that requires a pipe discharge. The PCI application process, and again, I caveat this with a permit to install that is submitted to a district office. An application is received. We require four copies of the plans and two copies of the appropriate forms and an associated fee. Fees are typically $200 plus a portion, a formula that uses the cost of the system. The step-by-step process and going through of how to obtain a permit to install is found at the website that is listed there on the website under the How to Obtain PCI tab. Ohio EPA obtains the permit to install. We start to review the application. Our turnaround time by internal review standards is typically 30 days. Most engineers are typically a little faster in getting back an answer. However, the length of the review process depends largely on the quality of the application. if there are many deficiencies and we have many rounds, then that will add to the time of the review. So a deficiency letter is typically returned back to the engineer, and once we have an application that is an approvable permit, we make the final recommendation to Columbus. The authorizations are then sent to Columbus, where it's checked for statewide consistency, and then the authorization is issued. Permits to install are issued by the director. It is also important to note that any permit that is issued by the director is appealable by anyone in the state of Ohio, and there is a process for that. In executing the permit to install, you should have a contact with the design engineer to oversee the actual construction and to ensure that the actual installation conforms to the permit to install. A typical requirement of a permit to install is that construction must start within 18 months. However, we have granted extensions to that 18 months, but we must have your request to extend it before the 18 months is expired. Stormwater considerations. There's a couple of handouts that were put out by Ohio EPA's Division of Compliance Assistance and Pollution Prevention. One is entitled, Does My Small Business Need a Stormwater Permit? Dated September 2010, which you may want to refer to. But commercial winemaking, no matter how large or how small, does have a standard industrial classification code of 2084, and under US EPA stormwater requirements, is subject to industrial stormwater requirements for activities that occur where you could expose those processes to storm events or just precipitation events. You either need to obtain a stormwater permit, or most facilities should be able to fit under a no exposure certification. No exposure certification may be found at Ohio EPA's website under the stormwater tab for EPA's Division of Surface Water at epa.ohio.gov/dsw in the topic list for stormwater. The no exposure certification requires you to basically go through and document that the activities that you're doing do not come into contact with stormwater, and basically indicates that you do not have to have a stormwater permit. This no exposure certification must be completed once every 5 years, basically for each permit cycle of a stormwater permit. If a stormwater permit is needed, you can either apply for an individual permit or apply for coverage under a general permit. And any questions, you may want to contact me here at the district office in Twinsburg, and my contact information is listed there.